420 हो जाएं सावधान। अब शुरू हुआ एक नया अभियान, कोई भी कहीं से घुमा सकता है ये नंबर 1811 4000। टोल में हो गड़बड़ और दाम भी हो बढ़कर, या किसी तरह की और गड़बड़, तो घुमाइए ये नंबर
1811 4000।
यही कंज्यूमर हेल्पलाइन।
Welcome back to Strong Medicine. Now, the credit for the ongoing drive to make medicines more affordable really goes to the Supreme Court. The government has been just following the Apex Court's order to make essential drugs available at cheaper prices. Here's a closer look at the case history.
चाहेंगे तो हमारे पास में कोई हथियार नहीं एक्शन लेने का, कुछ नहीं कर सकते हैं। ये मैं आपको मैं बतलाता हूँ, एज ए मिनिस्टर मैं बतलाता हूँ, क्योंकि जो जो गवर्नमेंट का जो जिस तरीके से वो सीधे थ्रेटनिंग देता है कि हम दवाई का उत्पादन बंद कर देंगे, आप जाइए, हम इंडस्ट्रीज हमारा आप चौपट करने के फिर में लगे हुए हैं।
As Union Minister for Chemicals and Fertilizers Ram Vilas Paswan has been much like a doctor who's diagnosed this malady but has found it difficult to administer the medicine. Just as in the case of many other ills, it took the Supreme Court to rise against profit margins as high as 1000% in the case of some drugs. Earlier this year, the Apex Court evoked right to life clauses in the Constitution and ruled the basic drugs should be made available at cheaper prices. So last month, the government brought 354 life-saving generic drugs under price control. And the National Pharmaceutical Pricing Authority got the mandate to oversee these price controls. The industry, however, struck a deal with the government and agreed to fix trade margins on generic drugs. The deal promised to slash retail prices by as much as 74%. It was decided that profit margins would be capped at 15% for wholesale and 35% for retail sales. That's around double the margins for the 74 bulk drugs, which have a cap of 8% for wholesalers and 16% for retailers. The industry had asked for 6 weeks beginning 2nd October for compliance. For imported drugs, the agreed deadline was 6 months. The industry, however, continued to oppose the move to revert to price control, which had been abandoned in the early 1990s, as interestingly did the Commerce Ministry and the Planning Commission. But the government held firm, and a fortnight ago, the industry voluntarily agreed to slash prices of 886 medicines. Analysts were quick to decry the move as a farce. That's because the list covering about 1% of the domestic drugs market did not include most drugs of common use. With Kumar Deep in New Delhi, Abhishek Sengupta, Headlines Today.
So everybody wants their drugs to be cheaper. In fact, the Supreme Court coming into the rescue for the consumers. Let's now get a perspective in as far as consumers go. Let's get a word in from Mr. Bijon Mishra, who's the CEO of Consumer Voice. He now joins us over the phone line. Thank you so much for joining us on the program, Mr. Mishra. What really do you see as the remedy? I was just asking a short while back Mr. Harinder Sikka, who's joining us in the studios, about this entire malady that seems to be afflicting the pharmaceutical sector. What, according to you, would be the remedy, really?
Remedy in the prices, you see, they have to understand the sensitivity of our consumers in our country in terms of to make sure that they are able to sell the medicines at a affordable price, accessible to people who need those medicines the most. And the laws never help, but what we are looking for and what we had initiated was that the industry will themselves rise on the occasion and show certain gestures in terms of making, you know, essential drugs and drugs which are commonly used by consumers, you know, made affordable and accessible. This is what we are hoping to happen, but it has not happened.
So you feel those gestures really haven't come out of the industry so far?
Absolutely not, because you see, what they have done is a kind of a list which they have prepared on their own, deciding on their in terms of where they have the least kind of effect in terms of profitability. I do appreciate that no industry can run without profit, but I definitely would not like industry to profiteer on with consumers. You know, that is where we are telling the industry that please lower your margins, please reduce and work in a lean manner so that you don't need to give all that kind of big doles to the medical practitioners.
Mr. Mishra. Let's just get a view on the points that he have been raising from Mr. Sikka himself. Would you agree with what Mr. Mishra has to say? Obviously not.
See, we have also, I agree with him that unbranded generics can never be or should not be priced at par with branded generics, because they are just copy products, and there's no research gone into it, there's no marketing gone into it, and there's no recall procedure, and there is not so many that a branded generic goes through. But it takes time for this industry, for the lower SSI kind of people, companies to come to terms to that kind of reality, because they have serious issues on their hand. They have Schedule M implementation coming up, without which they cannot exist. It should also be appreciated by consumers that we are cheapest in the world, not only in USA, not only in Europe, UK or Pakistan. We are cheaper than Bangladesh.
And that makes it really cheap, doesn't
it? That makes it really cheaper. We also have a serious issue of patents. No longer can we be reverse engineering the products which we were doing yesterday. We have to do your own research today. A new drug which overseas costs to research up to $1.5 billion, even if it costs you 100 million, and if it fails, you are 4,000 crore down the drain. Now, not very many companies can afford this kind of margins and this kind of. I'm not saying that the company should charge 1,000%, and therefore we have come out voluntarily. Now, if some companies or large players, as I said, there are over 20,000 players who have to come on board to adopt the same policy which the major players have adopted, it is going to be taking some time. We cannot really expect a button to be pressed, and we also must appreciate that whichever drugs come under price control, those drugs can never get delivered to the rural areas. The reason
so that's a fair point that you're raising. Let's just ask Mr. Mishra in on this. Mr. Mishra, the point really that Mr. Sikka is making here is that it's all a question of time, really. Give them time. We're talking about 886 right now. That number is just likely to go up. How would you respond to that?
Well, I definitely appreciate that we have to give kind of a certain timeline. What we are unable to understand that why are they not coming out with a clear timeline saying that by such and such date, we assure you that this change will take place. Why did they agree in the minister's proposal or the ministry's proposal in terms of coming out with a list which doesn't have any consequence, you know, in terms of bringing a change which we have been talking about? Why did they kind of, you know, develop a kind of a mechanism where they built a high hope within the consumers that we are trying to bring down the prices of medicines?
All right, Mr. Mishra, that's your perspective on this. Mr. Sikka, aspect about a clear timeline that Mr. Mishra is raising over there.
First of all, out of 25,000, about 10,000 are not even registered. And those who are, they are so vastly spread out. And there are so many cross currents, so many diversifications between them. If the major players have decided, they have no choice
but to fall
in line. And to give an exact line, exact time in this vast country, I think anybody who does that and provides, say that by so and so time, there will be bilingual printing, there will be a change in this policy, and there will be change in this drug pricing, and drug prices will be announced, and it will all happen simultaneously. I think we are asking for a little
too much. Too soon.
But the fact of the matter is, it's on track. The very fact that 886 drugs did get announced, then there were lacunas, then there were problems in that so-and-so drugs do not exist actually, or they are not in production, will evolve over time. And there is
right.
no way but
right. Hold that thought, Mr. Sikka. We'll just come back to you. Mr. Mishra, also we'll come back to you to get your perspective on this entire issue that seems to be plaguing the pharmaceutical industry. Time for us to take a bit of a pause. We'll come right back and we'll tell you more about how fake drugs are really infesting the entire industry. Stay tuned to Biz Today. You're watching Strong Medicine. Now, if you talk about the problem for patients in India, it's not just that the medicines are really expensive. There's an even bigger problem at stake. And what is this? Well, it's just as widespread as drugs being expensive, and this is the case of fake drugs.
Haven't you wondered why your tried and tested medicines sometimes fail to work? The answer can be really quite simple and very worrying. You might be buying fake medicines, mistaking them for genuine labels. Leading drug manufacturers are equally worried. Some claim that of the 25,000 manufacturers across India, as many as 10,000 make fake medicines, which is why they argue fake medicines are available off the shelves in just about every part of the country.
The recommendation is a new policy on anti-counterfeiting, which is a law which was to be brought by Parliament, should be brought in. That means it's a penal action for anyone who makes counterfeit drugs.
The big players have made a few concrete recommendations, which they say should be made mandatory for all manufacturers. The idea is to weed out spurious drug manufacturers. The industry believes it can fight the menace of fake medicines by adopting state-of-the-art packaging, which makes it difficult to copy. Barcoding can also help, as can installation of radio frequency identification devices or RFID on medicine batches to track the delivery to retailers and then consumers. But most importantly, penalties should be made far more stringent. There is a downside though. Some analysts say prices are bound to rise due to these measures. While the issue of controlling the drug prices needs to be tackled immediately, the issue about the sale of counterfeit drugs also requires immediacy because it affects consumers in the rural and the semi-urban areas. Kumar Deep, Headlines Today, New Delhi.
So everybody wants their cheap drugs, but nobody wants fake drugs. Mr. Sikka, let me get you in on this first. Nicholas Piramal, it's known to really go all out and suggest an anti-counterfeit policy. We're talking about a very serious issue here. Do you think the government is really being lax about the entire issue at stake?
I had two meetings with the Honorable Prime Minister once, as recent as when I accompanied him to Brazil. Now, the question is very simple. If government desires to bring a bill as such as anti-spurious drugs, then it can bring it almost overnight because there is a cross-party agreement on this issue. But when it wanted to bring an Office of Profit bill, it came out of nowhere and it got passed. But as serious an issue as a fake drugs bill, it is languishing for past 8 years. Those very fake drugs are not only going to civilians, those drugs are also being flooded into the pipelines and blood veins of our soldiers. Now, is it fair for government to sit on such a vital issue? I must at the same time clarify to you that industry does not lose money because of fake drugs. Because more people take fake drugs, they actually have to come back to genuine drugs at a higher strength. So we actually stand to gain. But is it the real gain that we want?
That's a fair point that you're raising. Mr. Mishra, coming to you about this entire anti-spurious thing, do you think it's just the government who needs to be taking care of this entire issue, or do the companies also have a role to play?
It is absolutely the onus is on the industry. If the industry really wants to eradicate spurious drugs, they have to again show very responsible actions. You know, I remember I was a member of the Mashelkar committee, which went into, you know, strong action against spurious drugs, where, you know, we have set a death sentence to people who practice such things. But how many cases are getting filed? What is the prosecution kind of a percentage? What is the conviction? Is zero. Because the industry is not interested. And as you just now heard, that they don't get affected because they can sell their higher potency drugs. That's why they don't want to do anything. And we as consumer organizations have been always telling the industry, especially the pharmaceutical industry, that look, it is time now you people demonstrated your responsibility towards the citizens.
Mr. Sikka, time now to demonstrate your responsibility to the citizens?
Now, I would like to inform Mr. Mishra and the consumers that industry has done and is doing whatever it can. We have also hired private detectives and so on and so forth. But so many times, n number of times, we have got companies arrested. And because there are no laws, because it is not cognizable offense, because it is not recognized, the offender comes out of bail within 24 hours and starts, instead of ABC, a DEF company. Unless and until it becomes recognized by government and also recognized by the fake producer that he is going to be penalized irrespective, it becomes cognizable, non-bailable, legal penalties involved, till then that man has too much of incentive.
But facing the brunt of it all really, Mr. Sikka, is the hapless patient. How really do you think he can make out the difference between fake drugs and real drugs?
We are not the police. People must understand that we have A, to make sure that our drugs reach from place A to place B across the country. We have so much of delivery chain.
So are you saying there's not enough infrastructure in place within the industry to be able to take care of such
a... It's not our business to have that infrastructure, that kind of infrastructure where we catch other fly-by-night operators. We cannot. There are
mafias out there. So what you're saying, it's just your business to like actually just churn out medicines without actually knowing whether they're fake or real, because at the end of some spectrum you also have...
What each company produces is genuine, but suppose I have a particular brand and it is very successful. Then for a fake producer, it's a very simple business to produce, also look like, and sell it at my cost. My brand, my product.
Mr. Sikka, your quick reaction to what Mr. Sikka is saying. Mr. Mishra, your reaction.
My reaction is very simple. They have a huge network of medical representatives who go to the nook and corner of the country. They could be the eyes and ears of the consumers to be able to detect and tell the company can give the feedback to consumer groups, and we will initiate action. They don't have to initiate action. We will do it on their behalf. We will hire the best of lawyers to fight these cases. We are ready
to
do that.
Mr. Mishra, thank you so much for joining us on the program. Pleasure talking to you. Mr. Sikka, also thank you so much for joining us on Strong Medicine tonight. So that was really where the issue stands as of now. We're all expecting the medicines to get cheaper, but when and how will they? Well, we just have to wait and watch for that. Thank you so much for joining us on Strong Medicine.